everyone.
Good morning.
I know it's early, but it's a wonderful day, and I'm very thankful for each one of you who have come out.
And it's not raining.
And it's not raining. We have many, many things to be thankful for. That's right. Oh, thank you very much. I may need that before the morning's over. I'm sorry. For all of those who are listening online, it may not be all of those, maybe a few at this time, we want to welcome you all. So the same as we do every Sabbath morning, I've been home most of these days, and I've missed you, but I've tuned in to every meeting. I've heard your testimonies, I've heard the music, I've heard the presentations, and I've been blessed, and I hope you've been too. But one of the advantages is that I could see who was listening in, who had came into the classroom, and who was on the phone. And we had, for the other speakers who may not know that, we had a good group of people listening in. So I was thankful for that also.
Amen.
Today our topic is on the investigative judgment, and not just the investigative judgment. I won't be speaking on what it is and how we come to that conclusion. My topic is living during the time of the investigative judgment. And there's, I was so blessed in my study. It's changed me. And I hope that it will have a blessing for you too. And because there's so much to cover, I know every speaker has this problem. I'm going to go swiftly through. I'm going to just talk to you. I'm not going to take time to give you the references. If we publish, it will be in the published work. But just know that I'm quoting scripture. Sometimes I'll give the quotes. I'm quoting Ellen White. You'll find them familiar to you probably. A.T. Jones, I give credit to all these people. But I just want to pull it together and present something to you that you can sit and listen, and it won't be a scholarly article or presentation. The present is a time of overwhelming interest to all living, rulers and statesmen, men who occupy positions of trust and authority, thinking men and women of all classes have their attention fixed upon the events taking place about us. They are watching the strained, restless relations that exist among nations. They observe the intensity that is taking possession of every earthly element, and they recognize that something great and decisive is about to take place, that the world is on the verge of a stupendous crisis. The Bible, and the Bible only, gives a correct view of these things. Here are revealed the great final scenes in the history of our world, events that already are casting their shadows before. The sound of their approach causing the earth to tremble and men's hearts to fail them for fear. Ellen White used several texts to emphasize our danger, two of which are, "Behold, the Lord maketh the earth empty, and maketh it waste, and turneth it upside down, and scattereth abroad the inhabitants thereof, because they have transgressed the laws, changed the ordinance, broken down the everlasting covenant," Isaiah 24:1-5. "Alas, for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come," Joel 1:15. Jeremiah wrote of the destruction that will come suddenly, how the mountains will tremble and the birds will flee. Other prophets warned of the great and terrible day of the Lord, and all of these prophets longed to understand the importance of the great scenes revealed to them. And here we are today, standing on the very verge and on the deep moment of their fulfillment. With living interest, We should approach the delineations of the things to come, events for which God's children have watched and waited, longed and prayed, but at this time, before the great final crisis, men are absorbed in the pursuit of pleasure and have lost sight of the unseen and the eternal. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels are burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousand thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. And this is where our study begins. The judgment was set, and the books were opened. We are living in the time of the investigative judgment, as were your parents, and as were my grandparents and their parents. And we are the fifth generation since the investigative judgment began in 1844, almost 174 years ago, if we allow 33 years to a generation. Has the judgment moved to the living? No, for the final test on the Sabbath has not yet come to God's people. But we know the final test will come soon. The signs pointing to its approach are upon us, and the very first sign of the end of the world, Jesus mentioned in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, is recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, is that many will come in his name and claim to be him. Have you ever heard anyone claim to be Christ? Maybe you have. Maybe you haven't. But many people have so claimed, and many are still claiming. People came to Ellen White claiming to be Christ with a message and counsel, etc., to her. But, excuse me, we are not likely to go to the desert or to the secret chamber to hear and see these false Christs because we know better. But some will go. Jesus was very clear that we are not to believe such claims, and he emphasized this by reminding us. He's told us. He wants us to understand the seriousness of its warning. In 1891, Elder J.N. Loughborough noted, "There was one point on which our minds were deeply impressed while listening to the reading of the testimonies from patriarchs and prophets and the great controversy concerning Satan's fall and his present workings, but especially what he is to do in the immediate future as he shall manifest himself as an angel of light, claiming to be Christ himself. It was shown," this is at the meeting where Loughborough was, "it was shown that it is not only the above writings, i.e. Patriarchs and Prophets and Great Controversy, that set forth what Satan is to do, but spiritualists themselves are now claiming that Christ meets with them in their circles, and that very soon he is to manifest himself personally in such an unmistakable manner that all will be compelled to believe. A false Christ was meeting with spiritualists in 1891, nearly 2,000 years after Christ warned of this deception, and these spiritualists claimed that Jesus would soon manifest himself in such an unmistakable manner that all would be compelled to believe him to be Christ. Even those devils agreed with what Ellen White said would come to pass. As the crowning act in the great drama of deception, Satan himself will personate Christ. The great deceiver will make it appear that Christ has come. Satan will manifest himself among men as a majestic being of dazzling brightness. His voice is soft and subdued, yet full of melody. He heals the diseases of the people and claims to have changed the Sabbath to Sunday and commands all to hallow the day which he has blessed. This is the strong, almost overmastering delusion. In 1844, a little flock of true-hearted Adventists expected Christ to come, but they were sorely disappointed. At a future time, it will again be a little flock of true-hearted Adventists who will know that the dazzling being who has come as Christ is actually an impostor. And Christ's command, go ye not out to meet him. To go would be to place yourselves under the influence of an almost overmastering delusion. Behold, Jesus said, I've told you. We may not physically go and see and hear a false Christ, but anyone with a computer can go instantly. And this is where we must be careful, not to look or to read about such a person on the internet. Spiritualistic deceptions abound. They proliferate on websites. They entice from these synagogues of Satan. And they snare from their published pages. We are to be on our guard. No longer do people need help from a medium to communicate with evil spirits. Consider Hillary Clinton and her supposedly self-help conversations with spirits claiming to be Eleanor Roosevelt and Mahatma Gandhi. Clinton was not around a table in a darkened room holding hands with a medium, waiting for the purported spirit of Roosevelt to speak, but it was a seance nevertheless. She herself was the medium, and through her and to her an evil spirit sent messages from an impostor, Mrs. Roosevelt. Today, spiritualism, we've already heard through the week, is rampant, and minds have become so deranged that just about anyone can be his or her medium and can communicate directly with evil spirits. This is what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. On December 5, 1912, the Federal Council of Churches of Christ met in Chicago, Illinois. By 1912, the council had grown to over 17 million members and 31 Protestant denominations. Their stated purpose was to show fellowship and unity in the Christian churches and to bring them into united service for Christ. What is significant about this meeting of the council is that one of its very first actions was to divorce itself from the word Protestant, because members of the council considered this word divisive and not representative of the unity they were seeking. Why emphasize a word that is not a uniting but a dividing word? A word that recalls a most unhappy and trying experience, said one. By using this word, you're making it more difficult for many of your Christian brethren to work with you, said another. And so, eliminating the use of the word was agreed upon to a round of applause. By repudiating this word, they removed the line of demarcation between Protestants and the Roman Catholic Church. No longer were these Protestants protesting anything. And by removing the separation between them, the persecution and martyrdom of God's faithful people were disparaged. The suppression of truth and the elevation of abominable falsehoods such as purgatory was elevated. The darkness of the Crusades downplayed, and the papal rule of fear in all aspects of life, from the cradle to the grave, was accepted. Remember, this was a Protestant council. But they wanted the Roman Catholics to be with them, and to do this, they had to eliminate the word Protestant. The spirit of Protestantism was renounced. In the protest of the regents at Spires in 1624, the right of the individual to think for himself in matters of religion and faith had been resolutely accepted, in contrast to the robot-like following of the dictates of the Roman Church. But in 1912, upholding this principle of individualized faith was surrendered for the supposedly better good of unity. Surrendering the principles of faith for the sake of unity is also what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. The right of private judgment in religion and the principle of individual responsibility to God are two essentials of the Protestant Reformation and of Christianity itself. The seemingly minor decision about just one word signaled a major reversal in thought. During the time of the Reformation, being a Protestant meant, according to Jones, number one, protesting against the burning or the destroying of men of faith and or their writings. Two, protesting against the condemnation of any man in his or her absence and without being heard. Three, protesting against any alliance between the ecclesiastical and the civil powers, and 11 more points that we can't go into. That is the spirit of Protestantism. It is not, however, the spirit under which we live today. Consider, for example, the current Seventh-day Adventist fundamental belief on the Bible. The Holy Scriptures are the supreme, authoritative, and the infallible revelation of His will. They are the standard of character, the test of experience, the definitive revealer of doctrines, and the trustworthy record of God's acts in history. These sentences sound good, and they sound right, but please consider the fact that no mention is made that the Bible is the only revelation of God's word, the only standard and test, the only trustworthy record of God's acts, and critically, the only revealer of doctrine. In addition, the word definitive is not restrictive. It leaves room for other sources to also be revealers of doctrine, as long as the other sources do not contradict the Bible. And just think for a minute of any other sacred, quote-unquote, sacred writing of other faiths. They could be looked at and even believed as long as they don't contradict the Bible, according to this. As long as the Bible still stands as supreme, authoritative, and infallible, and the standard, the secondary sources can be accepted as a source of doctrine, maybe not as supreme and authoritative, but still a source, unless you are a true Protestant and know that the Bible and the Bible only is the rule of faith and duty. The phrase, the Bible only, excludes everything else from consideration, and so it should. There are no sources for doctrine beyond the Bible, including the writings of Ellen White. She always pointed people back to the Bible. Satan's manner of working against God and His Word has not changed. He is still as much opposed to the scriptures being made the guide of life as in the 16th century. In our time, there is a wide departure from their doctrines and precepts, and there is need of a return to the great Protestant principle. the Bible, and the Bible only as the rule of faith and duty. The 1872 principles of statements of fundamental principles taught that the Bible is the only unerring rule of faith and practice. And this principle carried through until 1980 when it was changed. Seventh-day Adventism has definitely left the great principle of Protestantism of the Bible and the Bible only. And Adventism has embraced another error rejected by the pioneers of our movement. J.N. Andrews wrote, "The doctrine of the Trinity was established in the Church by the Council of Nice, A.D. 325. This doctrine destroys the personality of God and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The infamous measures by which it was forced upon the Church, which appear upon the pages of ecclesiastical history, might well cause every believer in that doctrine to blush." Living in the midst of doctrinal error and amid the loss of Protestantism by the SDA Church is also what it is like to live during the time of the investigative judgment. The beautiful principles of Protestantism were denied by this council in 1912. What Protestant denomination today understands the depth of what has been lost since the days of the Reformation? Probably none. But we can, thanks to our early leaders and to the inspiration given Ellen White. The great truths of Protestantism flared brightly after the morning star of the Reformation began to write and preach. But several decades later, began to fade and have been fading ever since. We cannot loosen our grasp on the Bible and the Bible only. Amen. And on, "Here I stand, I can do no other." Luther was the man for his time, and we are the men, women, and young people for our time. Amen. To uphold and to further the Protestant Reformation we are called. But not to this only. More importantly, we are called to perfection. While the investigative judgment is going forward in heaven, while the sins of the penitent believers are being removed from the sanctuary, there is to be a special work of purification, of putting away of sin among God's people upon earth. This work is more clearly presented in the messages of Revelation 14. When this work shall have been accomplished, the followers of Christ will be ready for His coming. This serious requirement of perfection is also what it is like to live during the time of the investigative judgment. What books were opened when the judgment was set? One book is the Book of Remembrance. In it are written words of faith, acts of love, every deed of righteousness, every temptation resisted, every evil overcome, every word of tender pity, every act of sacrifice, every suffering and sorrow endured for Christ. That's the Book of Remembrance. Another book, pardon me, is the Record of Sin. In it are written every wrong word, every selfish act also full, every unfulfilled duty, every secret sin, every artful dissembling, heaven-sent warnings or reproofs rejected. I'm guilty of that also. And 16 more, Ellen White lists. The Lord also has, quote, his book. I don't know what any other name for it, but she refers to his book, and in which he records, quote, records every decision, pardon me, and the circumstances which brought about the decision, end quote. That's in this his book. The context is board and committee meetings concerning God's work. But we are at a meeting. We're at camp meeting. And decisions are being made here, right now perhaps, about how God's work will proceed in our lives. Jesus said in Luke 8:18, take heed how we hear. Also recorded in one of heaven's books, I don't know which one, it just says one of heaven's books, she writes this. I saw that every privation the servants of God have endured are all written in the book. Every tear is bottled up, every pang of agony they have endured is recorded in the book. I know thy works, says the true witness, all that has been done to help the servants of God. That's you and me helping other people. All that has been done is all recorded. All of it is written in the book. All the selfish withholding from God's servants are all written in the book. So that's another book. In 1882, pardon me, Ellen White wrote a combined letter of counsel to a brother, whom I'll call Brother A, and to the Battle Creek Church, concerning their treatment of a teacher at the Battle Creek College, whom I'll call Brother C. Brother A and the Battle Creek Church were critical of Brother C and treated him poorly. Even students at the college, who at one time appreciated Brother C's work as a teacher, turned against him. Here is how she described a dream concerning this. I heard the testimonies borne by students against Brother C. Those very students had received great benefit from his thorough, faithful instruction. Once they could hardly say enough in his praise. Then it was popular to esteem him. But now the current was setting the other way. These persons have developed their true character. I saw, here's another book, I saw an angel with a ponderous book open in which he wrote every testimony given. Opposite each testimony were traced the sins, the defects, and errors of the one who bore it. Then there was recorded the great benefit which these individuals had received from Brother C's labor. In the ponderous book, the angel wrote each testimony given against Brother C, the sins, defects, and errors of the person giving the testimony, the great benefits which that person had received from Brother C. Every critical statement made to attack, defame, or cause suspicion, maybe concerning someone with whom we work, maybe a pastor or a leader, maybe a member of our church fellowship, is our testimony. Are we willing for our sins, defects, and errors to be publicly displayed, and for the benefits we have received from the person we're demeaning to also be displayed and recorded as a testimony against us? It would be far better to remember what the person has done to benefit us, and to remember that in God's sight, we are just as bad, perhaps worse, than the person we are talking about. It would be better for us to remain quiet than to publicly demean someone. I'm talking publicly. I know there's a process where we go to each other, but to publicly demean someone. Jesus' counsel is cast the first stone if you are without sin. Instead, let us seek to edify. The casting of stones is also what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. I saw that the Lord in judgment will, at the close of time, walk through the earth. The ministers of God will have done their last work, offered their last prayers, shed their last bitter tear for a rebellious church and an ungodly people. Their last solemn warning has been given. At this time, Ellen White says, how quickly these people who have repulsed the offers of mercy, would have given up houses and lands to have salvation explained to them, or to hear a hopeful word, or a prayer, or an exhortation from their ministers. But no, they must hunger and thirst on in vain. Their thirst will never be quenched. No consolation can they get. Their cases are decided and eternally fixed. It is a fearful, awful time, Ellen White says here. The repulsion of mercy is what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. But for those of us who heed God's call, Satan has his snares. I was moved by the Spirit of the Lord to write that book. The book she's talking about is Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4, The Precursor to the Great Controversy. And while working on it, I felt a great burden upon my soul. I knew that time was short and that the scenes which are soon to crowd upon us would at the last come very suddenly and swiftly. As the condition of the church and the world was open before me and I beheld the fearful scenes that lie just before us, I was alarmed at the outlook. I was shown the heresies which are to arise, the delusions that will prevail, the miracle-working power of Satan, the false Christs that will appear, that will deceive the greater part of the religious world, and that would, if it were possible, draw away even the elect. This book, The Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 4, contains a section that is not included in our current great controversy. It records a conversation, and you probably are aware, that Satan holds with his angels and reveals a number of Satan's plans. I've listed them all. I was going to list them all. Plus a few more, and there are 34 in number. But here are a few. Number one, this is Satan's plan for us. It's not for the world. He already has the world. This is his plan for us. Number one, to hold our minds in darkness until the investigative judgment is over. Two, to exalt Sunday and to lead the SDA church. I put that in brackets, but that's the conversation is about us. To lead the SDA church, to unite with the world in its support. Three, to work by signs and wonders, to blind our eyes to the truth, and to lead us to lay aside reason and fear of God and follow custom and tradition in the support of Sunday worship. Four, to influence popular Adventist ministers to turn the attention of us Adventists away from the commandments of God and to represent the law as a yoke of bondage, because Satan knows most of the people will accept the ministers' explanations and will not investigate for themselves. So that's one of his snares for us. And then I have eight, because I dropped some. Number eight in this list, to exert all his wisdom and subtlety to deceive and ensnare those who honor the true Sabbath, And going on to number 34 was spiritualism, which we've already talked about, and so have others. Living among the snares of Satan is what it is like to live in the investigative judgment. We probably have traveled here without major issues. Most of us sleep in peace and have food on our tables, and usually we are happy, and for this we praise God. But if we allow ourselves to appreciate unseen realities, these snares and how Satan works, if we allow ourselves to appreciate unseen realities, it would change us. Gone would be the tendency to light-hearted frivolity. We would move with greater care and with deeper seriousness of soul. Nowhere can we go that Satan is not there laying a trap for us. And I found 34, there are probably more. For example, Satan and his angels or in the assemblies where the gospel is preached. Maybe not me, but right here.
Yeah.
While angels of heaven endeavor to impress hearts with the word of God, the enemy is on the alert to make the word of no effect. And this part really touched me. With an earnestness equaled only by his malice, we all know there's no one worse than Satan. And that malice is equaled by his earnestness to try to thwart the work of the Spirit of God. Living among the unseen activity is what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. Following their disappointment in 1844, a group of believers with heavy hearts made their way through despondency and discovered to their joy the truth about what actually occurred on October 22, 1844. God helped the little flock, and in those early years, the pillars of their faith and our faith were settled deep in heads and hearts. To them, precious truths were given, but many of these truths, I can say all of them because of what I'm going to read later, were devalued, tarnished, and even tossed aside as portrayed in a dream of William Miller contained in early writings. I dreamed that God, by an unseen hand, sent me a curiously wrought casket about 10 inches long by 6 square, made of ebony and pearls, curiously inlaid. To the casket, there was a key attached. I immediately took the key and opened the casket when, to my wonder and surprise, I found it filled with all sorts and sizes of jewels, diamonds, precious stones, and gold and silver coin of every dimension and value, beautifully arranged in their several places in the casket. And thus arranged, they reflected a light and glory equaled only to the sun. He shared the casket and jewels with others who shouted for joy and wonder, but as the spectators increased, trouble came in, and the contents of the casket were handled, dropped, scattered as rubbish, covered with dirt, shavings, and sand, and mixed with innumerable spurious gems and coins, so that, did I emphasize it, this impressed me, every genuine jewel and coin was covered from sight. Miller was distraught and extremely concerned that he would never recover the genuine from the trash. But a man with a dirt brush entered the room, cleaned out the rubbish, saved every jewel and coin, no matter how small. When the work goes forward, under the direction of the angel who joins the third angel in the message to be given to the world, God will use ways and means by which it will be seen that he is taking the reins in his own hands. The workers will be surprised by the simple means that God will use to bring about and perfect his work of righteousness. This is what it means to live in the time of the investigative judgment, a time when truth is trampled upon and devalued. Every truth, you see, every gem was covered. Mm-hmm. But a time when God takes the reins in his own hands. In the process, we may lose faithful standard bearers, I'm sorry to say. And the light of others whom we thought were faithful standard bearers will go out. The time is not far distant when the test will come to every soul. The observance of the false Sabbath will be urged upon us. The contest will be between the commandments of God and the commandments of men. At this time, the gold will be separated from the dross. True godliness will be clearly distinguished from the appearance and tinsel of it. Many a star we have admired for its brilliance will then go out in darkness. But among earth's inhabitants, scattered in every land, and I'm reminded of it here in camp meeting, scattered in every land, there are those who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Like the stars of heaven, which appear only at night, these faithful ones will shine forth when darkness covers the earth and gross darkness the people. And then she mentions that in Africa, Europe, South America, China, India, the islands of the sea, and in all the dark corners of the earth, God has his faithful chosen one. Isn't that beautiful? Amen. That's you and me. God has in reserve a firmament of chosen ones that will yet shine forth amidst the darkness, revealing clearly to an apostate world the transforming power of obedience to his law. Even now they are appearing in every nation, among every tongue and people, and in the hour of deepest apostasy, when Satan's supreme effort is made to cause all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive under penalty of death the sign, etc. I know we're running out of time, but I need to hurry on. But the last sentence, the darker the night, the more brilliantly they will shine.
Amen.
To stand in defense of truth when the majority forsake us, and to fight the battles of the Lord when champions are few, is what is needed to faithfully live in the time of the investigative judgment. But what about those faithful standard bearers? This is so pitiful. Who knows whether God will not give you up to the deceptions you love? Who knows but that the preachers who are faithful, firm, and true may be the last who shall offer the gospel of peace to our unthankful churches. It may be that the destroyers are already training under the hand of Satan and only wait the departure of a few more standard bearers to take their places. And with the voice of the false prophet cry, peace, peace, when the Lord hath not spoken peace. This picture Ellen White, she said, I seldom weep. But now I find my eyes blinded with tears. They are falling upon my paper as I write. It may be that ere long, the word ere long, of course, means soon. It may be that ere long all prophesyings among us will be at an end, and the voice which has stirred the people may no longer disturb their carnal slumbers, published 1882. This is what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. Yea, the Lord has not spoken peace, peace. Instead, he has spoken the command to come out of Babylon. What is Babylon? It is not God's church. God has a church. It is not the great cathedral, neither is it the national establishment, neither is it the various denominations. It is the people who love God and keep his commandments. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. Where Christ is, even among the humble few, this is Christ's church. For the presence of the High and Holy One, who inhabiteth eternity, can alone constitute a church. The High and Holy One will never constitute a church that teaches error about himself and that breaks his own commandment by making the Holy Spirit a co-equal, co-eternal God on level with himself. Never. When Ellen White wrote about the church not being Babylon, it was the year 1893. And no fundamental belief existed on Trinitarianism at that time. It did not enter our organization's belief, not I said our, it did not enter the organization's belief structure until after her death, when it was published in the 1931 SDA yearbook. The church, be it the denomination or God's people, was not Babylon in 1893, for it was true to the principles that had been developed, remember, settled in head and heart, developed by God since its early days. In the following references, mostly from 1893, Ellen White consistently referred to the church as the people of God, and never to an organized denominational structure, unless so specified, which she did once. God is leading out a people. He has a chosen people, a church on the earth, whom he has made the depositaries of his law. The message to pronounce the church Babylon and call the people of God out of her does not come from any heavenly messenger, and I'll just stop there. The church is God's chosen people, she says. And if it would be ridiculous to call God's chosen people out of his chosen people, it just doesn't make sense. Next slide. God has a people in which all heaven is interested, and they are the one object on earth dear to the heart of God. Let everyone who reads these words give them thorough consideration, for in the name of Jesus I would press them home upon every soul. When anyone arises, whether among us or outside of us, who is burdened with a message which declares that the people of God are numbered with Babylon, etc., you may know that he's not bearing the message of truth. Now the next slide, this is God has a people and they are the one object, is the point of this particular quotation. The next one tells us who that one object is. The Church of Christ, enfeebled and defective as she may appear, is the one object on earth which he bestows in a special sense his love and regard. So the Church of Christ refers back to the people mentioned in the previous reference, putting the two together based on the idea that this is the one object that God bestows his favor upon. Today, as in the past, all heaven is watching to see the church develop in the true science of salvation. Christ has bought the church with his blood. Only people are bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, not a denomination. And all of this is, you'll see, Review and Herald, 1893, except for one or two. God has a church on earth who are lifting up, so forth. Are is plural. It's the people. Again, we read, God has a church upon the earth who are his chosen people. The fallen denominational churches are Babylon. Why are they fallen? Because of their poisonous error, we go on to read, Babylon has been fostering poisonous doctrines, the wine of error. This wine of error is made up of false doctrines, such as the natural immortality of the soul, eternal torment. I'm going to skip on, where, and she ends in this particular section. These and kindred errors are presented to the world by the various churches. And one of those kindred errors is Trinitarianism. Amen. Many people do not understand the difference between the denomination and the church of God, which is his people. Nor do they understand that leaving a denomination, whether it be a Sunday keeping or a Sabbath keeping, a denomination that is teaching error is a matter of life and death. Mm-hmm. Often you will hear phrases like, the ship is going through, mm-hmm. or don't leave the church because it's going through, and the church is going through. But the denomination is not, because of the poisonous errors that it has officially embraced. Trinitarianism is, yes?
To say, Onycha, yes. In Thessalonians to Ministers,
yes.
where she writes about this, the heading is the remnant church is not Babylon.
Oh, very good.
It's a remnant church. The
okay.
remnant church can never be.
That's right. Yeah. I agree. Mm-hmm. The true church. Okay. Poisonous errors that it has officially embraced. Trinitarianism is one of them. I don't have to tell you that, but it is. I'm just mentioning it. But this error points to a greater one, mm-hmm. that of blasphemy. Mm-hmm. To exalt God's Spirit as co-equal, co-eternal with the Ancient of Days is a form of blasphemy of the highest order. The Jews wanted to stone Jesus for the blasphemy of claiming that he and his Father were one. They charged him with blasphemy when he claimed the power only God has to forgive sin. But the SDA denomination has exalted God's Spirit to be God, and as God would thus have all the powers of God. The denomination is not going through, I'm sorry to say, but it has and is, in its leadership and in its beliefs, done blasphemy to God's Spirit.
That's right.
On a secondary note, when Ellen White referred to a ship going through, she was not speaking of the church, denominated or true, going through, but to God's work going through. He would see it through. Confusion about Babylon is what it is like to live in the time of the investigative judgment. When Hezekiah sent an invitation to all Israel and Judah to come to Jerusalem and keep the Passover, his messengers were laughed to scorn and mocked. Nevertheless, some came, and many people kept the Feast of Unleavened Bread and Passover, and idolatrous altars were taken away and cast into the brook Kidron. In the invitation are these words, "For if ye turn again unto the Lord, your brethren and your children shall find compassion before them that lead them captive, so that they shall come again into this land. For the Lord your God is gracious and merciful, and will not turn his face from you if ye return unto him." This promise is for us individually. If we turn again to the Lord, we shall find mercy. But it is not for a denomination. Matthew 11:5 describes us spiritually. The blind receive their sight. The lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. We have been blind, lame, leprous with sin, deaf, dead, and poor, but all this has changed because Jesus came. He bids the darkness flee. He enables us to walk in straight paths. He cleanses us from our sin, opens our ears to the words of heaven, raises us to new life, and makes us rich in his goodness and truth. All glory to God. The experience of being made new is the best part of living during the time of the investigative judgment. Do you remember the third angel's message? And I can't take time to read it, but we know it. God has given us this message to prepare us to be true to him during the time of the investigative judgment. It is to give us a backbone to stand for God now and until Jesus returns. God's purpose in giving the third angel's message to the world is to prepare a people to stand true to him during the investigative judgment. And preparing us to stand true to God during the investigative judgment, I'm going to have to skip that, also refers to the work of Adventist schools, publishings, works, sanitariums, etc. Standing true to God is what it is like to live during the time of the investigative judgment. Here's just a little list of what we've covered, and I had twice as much to share with you. I want you to know I filtered it out. But these are the things we covered today, and this is what it is like. My topic was living during the time of the investigative judgment. This is what it is like to live with all of this going on. But more importantly, the Lord is weighing character, not just our deeds, our character, in the sanctuary today. And those who are careless and indifferent will not stand the test. We cannot wait until the judgment before we consent to deny self and to lift the cross. It will be too late then to form characters for heaven. It is here and now that we must take sides with the humble, self-denying Redeemer. It is here we must overcome envy, strife, selfishness, love of money, and love of the world. It is here that we must enter the school of Christ and learn the precious lessons of meekness and lowliness of mind. And here it must be our aim and our earnest effort to be loyal to the God of heaven by obeying all his commandments. Be not deceived by the great adversary of God's law. When the judgment is set and the books opened, your life and mine will be measured by the law of the Most High. Amen. Those who have washed their robes of character and made them white in the blood of the Lamb will be found keeping the commandments of God. And when every man is judged according to the things written in all those books we learned about, they will receive the commendation of heaven and an eternal inheritance. Amen. And here is our high calling, to have our robes of character washed white in the blood of the Lamb. There is no other way. This is how we must live in the time of the investigative judgment. Amen. Let's close with prayer. Father, we know we are in a solemn time, a great time. We didn't ask to be here. You chose us to be here.
Amen.
So we give you the glory and the honor for giving us this privilege, but we need your help. We can't do it, Lord. Satan is on our track every second of night and day. So we thank you for the protection of your angels. But Father, it is not just a matter of the deeds that we're doing. I know they reflect our character, but we must put things aside, this sin that tracks us every moment. Help us to put it away, Lord. Help us to be willing to be made willing, even to purify, to allow you to purify our hearts and our minds. There's no other way. There's no way we can make it from this point to heaven without that happening, because you're coming soon. You've been patient with us. Help us, Father, to cooperate with you. And we give you all the honor and glory. We are nothing. You are everything, but somehow you make us jewels and lights that will shine in the firmament. So bless us to this end. Help us to live solemnly, yet joyfully, knowing that you are leading and guiding us through this time of the investigative judgment, I ask. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.